asked to kind of talk about be first to the future, using about digital, bit of technology. So what I'm going to talk to you about is kind of three things. Technology, as you would expect, the pace of change, and I'm going to leave you with some practical things that you can take away from today and get you started on how this thing's going to change essentially what you guys are doing. So first of all, does anyone recognize these two photos? The 2008 Beijing Olympics and then 2012, the London Olympics. Can anyone notice the distinct difference in these two photos? The phones, yes, we've got it here. Cameras in 2008. 2012, there's no cameras, it's all smartphones. Interestingly, in 2012, Kodak filed for bankruptcy. Only 3 months later did Facebook pay £1 billion for a smartphone app that takes photos. That's how fast this world is now changing with technology. So my key message to you is, the pace of change is accelerating. I've got good news for you. Today is the slowest day you will ever experience in technology. Just think about that. Tomorrow it's twice as fast. And the day after it's four times as fast. Who's familiar with Moore's Law? Okay, so change with technology is exponential. We have a futurologist at Google who talks about an intuition about the world as linear. We are comfortable as humans taking 30 steps and getting to 30. But that doesn't happen in technology. You take 30 steps and you get to a billion. Your brain struggles to compute with this. I often tell a little story about this. When I was about 7 or 8 years old, my parents used to drive from Fife in Scotland, which is up on the East Coast, all the way to Brittany in France. Now, that was 722 miles. Used to take us about 2 days. Now, if the speed of vehicles had developed at the same pace as computers, how long would it take me to get to France today? Less than a second. So if you imagine 2 days to a second, that's how fast computers now go. So we're getting faster. Tomorrow that's half a second, and then we're into milliseconds and nanoseconds. So I can give you some guarantees in this, that change is the only thing that will happen. The world's changing, technology's changing, and people are changing. Let's have a quick look at that. So, everyone talks about everyone is online. That's not really true. Only 2.4 billion people are online. There are still another 5 billion people who have not got internet access yet. However, we believe by 2020, 100% of those people will then come online. So in 5 years' time, the whole world will be connected. Now, if you imagine again how fast the world has moved in the years that we've had internet, we're only a third of the way there. In the next 5 years, you're going to see that transform and revolutionize the world. What's doing this then? What's the technology? So you've got phones that you can now buy for £30. Did anyone see the Android One that was announced the other day? The cheapest smartphone now available on the market. £30 tablets. You can get a tablet device for £30. It's incredible how cheap these things are, and by that cost means that anyone can have access to it. Now, these are internet-enabled devices. Raspberry Pi. Is anyone familiar with kind of Kickstarter and the online crowdfunding thing? Raspberry Pi is a credit card-sized computer. There's enough processing power in this that fits in their credit card that people can put it in their pocket and carry these computers around. Project Loon, this is a Google-owned project. We're putting balloons into the sky that emits internet signal. That's how we're giving everyone else the internet all around the world. And in internet.org, this is about getting accessible internet at good prices for everyone around the world as well. So we're empowering people to have access to the internet. So, we're entering this new world of six screens, as we call. You've got the desktop, you've got the mobile, you've got tablets. Your TVs are changing. Is anyone familiar with Chromecast, Google Chromecast? It's a little £30 dongle you put it in the back of your TV and it takes any TV and makes it a smart TV. So you can now control the content and watch YouTube videos on your TV. So no longer are you constrained by mainstream broadcast TV channels. Wearable technologies. Did anyone see the iWatch the other week? It's a new piece of technology. Again, these things can tap into your life. They can understand how fast you're moving. They can understand kind of how your what your pulse rate is, and they can understand how fit you are. The other one, did anyone see the Google Iris project where you kind of put the thing on the eye and it measures your glucose levels? Again, wearable technology is changing the way we think about it. And of course, the in-car heads-up displays. You now no longer need satellite navigations. You've got all the maps on your phone. But what if you didn't even need your phone? It just comes up on the windscreen. So all of these technology pieces are changing the way that people interact. So that's technology. What about people then? So way back in 2010, nobody trusted the internet. Fast forward 3 years. Oh, sorry. 2010 is mobile. My apologies, but I'm on to the next slide. 2010, mobile. 2013, 30% of people are using the smartphone to do all... Now, this is all Google searches. So just in 3 years, we've had three times as many people. The number of YouTube videos. Mind-blowing how many people watch YouTube videos. We were talking to some of the digital media sessions earlier. You would not believe what some people are watching on YouTube as well. 10 hours of a train driving from Oslo to Stromsgodset. Crazy, right? But in 2010, there were 6 billion videos being watched. Now there's 12 billion only 3 years later. The amount of content consumers and people are changing as a result. And this is when I was on about the internet. Way back in 2005, nobody trusted the internet. Fast forward to today, we not only trust the internet, we want the internet to understand who we are and deliver us a better experience. So again, people's attitudes are changing to technology. So, what do people need to do? In this accelerated world, this is getting faster and faster and faster. The only way really to kind of get ahead of it is to exceed this pace of change. How do you stay ahead of this pace of change? Now, I'm going to show you some commercial examples, and I'm going to talk a bit about kind of what businesses are doing, and then I'm going to come on to some of the stuff that you guys can do for some of the non-profit stuff as well. So, how do you succeed in this accelerated world? You innovate and grow. So, you can make beautiful mistakes, and you can adapt fast. Sounds quite crazy, right? Let's have a look at some examples then. So yesterday, you imagine Tesco's, and you take Nike. Apologies, I couldn't change this ahead of the Tesco announcement the other day. They may not be around much longer. But before, there used to be a grocer. Now we kind of, and Tesco, you see, they're kind of into the sports apparel. As they've kind of fast-forwarded and adapted to this technology, Tesco's are into tablets, they're into online video streaming. They're selling their own mobile phones. We had the case study earlier on in the digital media session about Tesco Mobile. You know, Tesco's used to just sell sell groceries. Now they're into everything. Tesco, Nike as well, wearable technologies. Anyone seen these kind of Nike fuel bands that you get? Again, it measures how active you are. You've got things that you can put in your trainers now, and it measures how fast you're running. Nike are into all this kind of accessible technology. Second then, make better decisions. We, again, in the digital media session, we were talking a bit about analytics, understanding your customers. But the way to make these better decisions is to understand the data. Morrison's. Anyone a wine aficionado in the room? Should see lots of hands go up here. So let me show you a video about this one. There we go. So as this plays, Morrison's recognize that not many people know the exact bottle of wine that they like. So what they did was they created this clever thing on the internet called the taste test, where you answer some really simple questions. Do you like sugar? Do you like salt? What's your favorite hot drink? Based on the answers to those simple questions, what they do is they narrow the results down. So they give you a result. And in this instance, your taste profile is fresh. They then take that fresh taste profile and they narrow the choice. So suddenly you've gone from thousands and thousands of bottles of wine to the 283 that might be relevant to you. Yeah? So again, you can use some of that data to help people on the internet. It's not about just kind of sticking everything on there, but it's about being clever, it's about being smarter. So that was kind of make better decision. And the final thing that these companies are doing really well is they're winning moments that matter. And what do I mean by that? They're there at the right time, the right place, and they're bringing their story to life. A lot of this media session we talked about earlier was about YouTube and kind of some of the stuff that you can do on YouTube. I've got a couple of examples of how brands are using YouTube to kind of connect with their audiences. They're no longer kind of faceless brands. 30 seconds in TV world is the kind of the nemesis. Yet everyone's constrained by the 30 seconds of what a TV ad can do. Any longer than that, it's very expensive. But 30 seconds is a hard time slot to get your message across. The great thing with YouTube is that you're not constrained. So I'm going to show you two examples. I'm going to show you a 30-second version, and I'm going to show you a slightly longer version of a video. And I just want you to have a think about how you felt after the first one, and then how you feel after the second one.
Sponsor of Moms.
So fairly standard kind of TV ad there.
P&G, proud sponsor of Moms.
So same story. One was 30 seconds, one was 2 minutes. On the second one, did it make you feel any better towards P&G? Who got the hair standing on the back of the neck when the girl comes flying over on the skis doing the slalom? Is it just me that gets that? You get more emotionally involved in the second one, right? Because you can tell a better story in more than 30 seconds. So there was a question in the digital media session earlier, and somebody said, oh, but you need to get professional production made for all of these videos and stuff. As long as it's authentic and it tells a story, it doesn't matter whether it's high production with George Clooney or whether it's you with your own smartphone. It's the story that matters. And that's the power that digital media can give you. So that was those two stories. So how do you be first of the future? Well, you innovate, you make better decisions, and you bring your story to life. So that gives you a bit of a flavour. Now, how can you get started? This is the thing. So you can leave here today and you can do some stuff. First things first, we've created what's called a digital health check. So if you go on to the website that we've created for all of this, it's called Grow Your Charity Online. I'll share the link with Roz, and we'll put it onto the Brick website so you can all get access to this this wonderful resource that we've created for you. But the first thing is, take the digital health check. Just work out where you are. Do you need to develop a new website? How does it perform? Do you have any understanding of this? Once you've kind of understood kind of what you've got and what's out there, the next thing you need to do is start to understand the impact that it's currently having. Does anyone have Google Analytics on their website? It's free. I would encourage you, if any of you have got a website, just tag it up with Google Analytics. It'll give you the most insightful information that you can use to then start to understand how your website works. And again, the resource will kind of explain all of that thing and how to do it in there. Next up, use the cloud. So there's lots of stuff on the cloud, but one of the great products that we've got in Google is Google Docs and Google Apps. Has anyone used Google Apps before? We've got one in the back. Yeah, so you've got this kind of word processing, you've got PowerPoint, you've got Excel spreadsheets. It's all there for free. And you've got some free storage that you can start to share stuff. And it does some really cool stuff as well. For anyone who works with a team of people that are not always co-located in the same place, this allows you to work on the same document together using the cloud. So both of you can be updating the spreadsheet at the same time, working on different bits, and you'll see where the other person's cursor is and stuff. We use it within Google. Again, it's all there, it's all free. So again, you don't need to be going out and paying for expensive licenses on word processors and Excel spreadsheet packages. Next up, in social media. We've had a lot of chat today about digital media and in particular social media as well. It's great for sharing your news, building communities. One of the best social networks that I love to use is actually YouTube. So again, there's lots and lots of people on YouTube. It's powered by Google Plus and the kind of the comments and stuff. But we use YouTube as our kind of social network within Google. And on that theme, using video to inspire your people. There's a quote from someone from Gartner who says that a picture paints 1,000 words, but a video tells 1.8 million words. So again, the impact of video and how to tell your story is very, very powerful. And again, YouTube is free to host your videos. You all need to do is create them. And then, of course, the other big thing, again, this was in the digital media session, is to go mobile. More and more people are getting smartphones. By the end of 2017, 95% of people will have mobile smartphones. That's 95% of everybody in the UK using a smartphone. Now, that said, about 55% of your website traffic will be coming from a mobile device as well. So if your website doesn't work on a mobile phone, it's incredibly frustrating for your users, and they'll be disengaged with your content. So it has to work on mobile phones now. You might have heard people talk about mobile first. You need to be mobile first in all of your thinking. Design your websites to work on mobiles. And then finally, advertise. So if you want to drive traffic and you want to drive volume to your website, you need to advertise and let people know it exists. Now, the great thing is, and you'll probably be excited to hear this bit, is that Google does do ad grants. So you can apply and you can complete an online questionnaire to find out whether you would qualify to receive in-kind advertising from Google. It's about $10,000 a month. So it's about £6,500 a month. So again, you can use that in-kind advertising to promote your charity, to promote the work you're doing, and to find new community members and drive that volume through to your websites. So that's it, 6 steps. I've quite enjoyed being here today. I hope you've kind of taken something out of that. I appreciate that this kind of accelerating pace of change is quite scary, but we need to embrace it. It's happening all around us, and have fun with it. Thank you very much.